Hi my friends, I'm Luca Turilli of Turilli the Owner Rhapsody and you are enjoying Sonic Perspectives.
Hello again, metal fans from all over the world. I am Rodrigo Ottaf with another interview for Sonic Perspectives. With me today is a very special guest who is one of the most gifted guitar players in the symphonic metal genre. I'm talking about Mr. Luca Turilli. Buongiorno Luca, come stai?
My pleasure, my friend, to be here with you tonight. Wow. Super warm here in Italy. I guess there in Brazil too, huh?
Well, I am Brazilian, but I'm in Toronto right now. It's summer, but you know, yeah.
Wow.
But you know, summer in Canada is not exactly summer. But anyway, it's a little warmer today. Yeah. Well, you have a new album out soon with your old partner in crime, Fabio Lione. Let's talk first about the album name, Zero Gravity, Rebirth and Evolution. I think this title to me suggests a fresh start for you guys. Am I right in that assumption?
Yes, absolutely. You're right, my friend, because of course we played our reunion and farewell tour to celebrate the 20th anniversary of the band. We celebrated around the world. In the beginning, we thought to play something like 6-7 shows, but then consider the success. We thought really it was a good idea to extend it for some more show. In the end, we arrived playing something like 70-75 shows. And it was an incredible experience. So we were really proud. We've been really proud to close the chapter related with the old Rhapsody, with the early years in that incredible way, and meeting all our fans around the world. So yes, Zero Gravity, Rebirth and Evolution represents really a new, fresh start, as you said.
Mm-hmm. And I think the new identity can also be seen on the new logo. Did you guys change it also to indicate this fresh start, or was it an attempt to modernize what you had before? What was the intention?
But the intention, first of all, was not even to call ourselves Rhapsody.
Oh.
But in some way, we were obliged to do it if we wanted really to continue, because right now in this kind of market, it's terrible in the sense that when you would like, for example, even two people, I mean, names kind of known, like the one of Fabio, mine, and so on. If you consider this, still it's very difficult to start with something new from zero, no?
Yeah.
So in the end, our first idea was even to leave metal forever after the farewell tour, to dedicate ourselves to some symphonic rock projects. There was also an idea to make something Fabio in the style of Queen, no? Of course, I speak for me about leaving metal. It was not about Fabio that is still performing with Angra, of course. No?
Uh-huh.
But yes, there were many ideas, many projects. I have a lot of... I'm a little bit bored of guitar, no? I want to dedicate myself now in the second part of life to the piano,
oh,
the keyboard that I like more. So, but in the end, you know, these were the plans after the farewell tour. But then happened that the promoters contacted us. They really wanted that we go on, because right now, for the same reason I told you before, in this kind of market, when something is successful, everybody is behind, you know?
Yeah.
So then me and Fabio thought, okay, do you want to make something together in the meta? Let's try. But we had another idea. They want to start with the band name Zero Gravity.
Mm.
So including new elements, what we like nowadays, when we listen to music, all that. So this was the first idea. But still, while for the management was great, for the promoters still was not good, because the offers were very bad, and we could have not even restart. It would have been really like to restart from zero, and at our age it's just not possible, you know?
Yeah.
So in the end, we sat around the table, many meetings, discussion, and we arrived to the perfect conclusion. We said, okay, they really want us, we go on as Rhapsody, but as we made the farewell tour, we want really to state this will be a new incarnation of the Rhapsody band. And so that's why we decided immediately to, of course, to add our names on top of the Rhapsody name, and then to change the logo, of course, into something that we like nowadays, because the old logo, I mean, let's forget about. So it's not my favorite style. It could have been great. It was great 20 years ago, but not really now. And so this was the first thing. And then second, we decided to take the band name that was supposed to be Zero Gravity and to turn it into the first album title. So, and then we also adopted the motto Rebirth and Evolution, really as motto of the band, as also as under title, to really state very clearly, especially before the crowdfunding campaign, so to let know all our fans which were our intentions.
Right. And it's great that you mentioned the crowdfunding campaign, because I was going to ask you about that. Were you surprised at how much the fans contributed this time?
Yes, it was really unbelievable, because first of all, we didn't know at all what to expect. It was our first try, and it was really to reach the same budget, let's say, that we had in the past with Rhapsody, no? So to guarantee the quality level that we always promised to our fans. So in some way, we were able to reach the same budget. We were able to realize the album we had in mind thanks to the contribution of our fans. And we even had some extra money to have a great video that will be released soon. To have the special guests on the album. Until now, we never had anyone singing with us on the album. So it was a great, it was a really great to add variety, because for us, the first fundamental thing that we want related to this new band is variety. Because, you know, I released something like 20 albums, if you look back at my discography, you know?
Yeah.
Fabio, many others. So the end, we are the first ones that would get bored if you would just repeat ourselves, and also we could just simply not play the same music that we were playing 20 years before and that now we don't like anymore. No, it was great at that time, but we don't feel it in the heart and the soul, let's say. So it's a big challenge. It's an artistic challenge. There are some elements that could be liked still by the old fans, because this was the case already when we released after our first lyric video related with our first single, Phoenix Rising, that is the first song on the album. Still, the old fans, they like it. So this means that there is a kind of connection, but at the same time, everybody understands our need, our urgent necessity to progress to a new modern direction.
Right. And you just mentioned the special guests that you have, and there's a great list of special guests on the album. You have Elise Reed from Amarante, Mark Basile from DGM, Sasha from Avantasia, and Arne from Santiano. How did everyone get involved in this recording?
And not only, because we have also Alessandro Conti, that is my previous singer of Luca Turilli's Rhapsody.
All right.
That sang the choirs. And the same for Emily Rani, that is normally is the soprano. I love her voice. I have her in every album. And so also she performed the choirs. But yes, let's say the special guests are really the one you named. We start with Elise. Wow, it was amazing, because I love the voice of Elise. Me and Fabio love it. So for us, it would have been just great to have it aboard, and it was possible. We were a little bit afraid, you know, what she will think. She will remember maybe the dragon swords and shield style of the past, and maybe she will not be interested. But then when she listened to the song, she understood it was something really moving to a new direction, the one we like nowadays, and really is reflecting also her taste. It was so easy. She loved the song, and we had her really, it was a joke. It was, she sent us all the parts. It was amazing, you know?
Right.
So, and that was with Elise. Then there was, okay, the case of Mark Basile. We had this song, I Am, that is kind of a progressive Queen style song, something like that in between, very modern. And so we thought, you have to know that I didn't know Mark Basile. And then when I discovered his voice, thanks to our studio engineer, that in the end is playing the guitar. His name is Simone Mularoni, and he's playing the guitar in the band DGM. So I was able to discover this band DGM, and also this amazing singer that for me is one of the best singer in Italy, together with Fabio and other few names, no?
Right.
So when I discovered his voice, I said, wow, he would be just perfect for this song, for a duet with Fabio, and that was the case, no? So... And then Sasha was more a kind of situation that this production, you have to know, was really tough, was tragic in the sense I had no time. We were close to the deadline. And in the end, for the bonus track, Oceano, I was really late. And I didn't want to make it fast, just to make it fast, because we have no time to rush it. So in the end, I asked Sasha that he was on tour with Avantasia. So I knew he was busy. But he was able to record the bass for that song while on tour, so it was a great gift he made to me. And then thanks to him, I entered in contact with this guy, Arne Wiegand, from this band, pop rock folk band called Santiano, a German band selling millions of copies. So a band that I didn't know, honestly, but the guy was amazing. He played the acoustic guitar. And the piano on the bonus track. So thanks to Sasha and Arne, we had everything done in time in the very last minute. So wow, thank you eternally.
Right, right. And let's talk lyric for a bit, because I only received the album yesterday, but it seems to me that many songs talk about fresh starts and new perspectives. Would you say there's a common theme on the album related to this new chapter in your career or not?
But let's say already, if you look at Turilli's Rhapsody, I started, of course, not having to deal with a saga, so not being obliged, no, to refer all lyrics, all music to the same subject. It was much more easy for me, and it was really a kind of, I felt really finally free to express myself really in all ways possible. What for a composer is really important, no? Because imagine that our saga connected something like 10 full-length albums. No, wow. To be honest, it was just 8 full-length albums and 2 EPs. But anyway, we are speaking about 15 years of career. So so imagine, no, I was always speaking about the same subject. It was great. It was a great artistic journey. But in the end, I felt really free to be able finally to speak about different things. In reality, when I say different things, it's not completely true. Why? Because we always spoke about the same subject, which is spiritual evolution, which is the intention to really express a positive energy through the music, the lyrics, the message. But in the end, before, it was just that it was filtered by a saga. Now, we give this message in a more direct way. So, you know, I'm practicing yoga, meditation. So I got access to this multidimensional aspect of life in many different ways. And for me, it's natural then to speak about all these things in the lyrics. So, but really, I imagine these lyrics like pieces of a big puzzle. So they speak about different things, but in the end, they are all interconnected. You know what I mean?
Right, of course.
So,
yeah.
So Phoenix Rising, Zero Gravity, Decoding the Multiverse, they all speak about the same thing. For example, Phoenix Rising speaks clearly about the higher self, and really the need for the higher self to expand, to evolve, to access the multidimensionality, to reach a higher level of consciousness. This is the basic for us to reach a higher level of consciousness. This is the basic thing. But then if you take every single lyric, then you will see that we have a song like Arcanum, Da Vinci's Enigma, that is based on the movie Da Vinci's Code, and is also a celebration for the great genius of Leonardo. And we speak more about the mystical aspect of the art of Leonardo. Because with our new band, we want really to explore the mysteries of life, science, quantum physics, because quantum physics is a little bit the branch of science that in some way is connecting in some way science, the scientific aspect, and the spiritual aspect, tries to connect in some way. It's just amazing. It's just amazing. And then, for example, we have a song like DNA, where we have the duet with Elise. And in that song, we speak about the projection theory of Carl Gustav Jung, that is one of my greatest maestros in some way. I love psychology, psychoanalysis, all that. And so it's great because we speak about the theory based on which we tend to project on another person the dark aspect of our personality that we are not able to accept as being part of ourselves, no? So all very interesting, super modern things. And I think the lyrics, the way I wanted really to write the lyrics is really very modern, serious, as I wanted, always wanted to have them.
Right. There are great lyrics on the album, so congratulations on that, man.
Thank you, my friend. Thank you.
And I read that you spent a long time in the studio to record it this time, and there was a particular focus on getting things right in the vocals department. There are a lot of very cool vocal arrangements on the album, and aside from the operatic moments you're known for, there's a lot of multi-layered vocals like Queen used to do, right?
Yeah, of course. That's why, of course, when the first idea was to create a rock symphonic project a la Queen in the style of Queen, then when we moved our plans in the direction of to really Leonard Rhapsody, we wanted really to anyway to include something, you know, in that style, because Queen is a band we love for the especially for these epic vocal arrangements we all know very well, you know, from albums like A Night at the Opera or Innuendo and so on. So yes, this is something we strongly wanted to have. And then yes, this band is based on the voice of Fabio. Because I have to tell you something, we didn't work together for a while before we met for the farewell tour. And it was something like 7, 8 years we didn't see each other. And after, when we met, I discovered his voice was even better than before. And this is something I cannot really still understand. But it's just great that it's like that. So, and yes, when we thought about continuing, then we said, okay, but everything will be music, whatever will be at the service of the voice. Because Fabio, for me, is one of the most undervaluated, how you say, underrated singers. Because mostly, okay, he's famous in the power metal, but I mean, Fabio could be really one of the 20 greatest singers in the music in general, in my opinion, no? And so we really wanted to focus on his voice because the way he interprets, the way he has his feeling, his touch, makes all the difference of the world. You know, as composer, you can compose whatever you want, but when you don't have a great vocal finalization, let's say, then the product, you know,
Loses
will not be
impact.
that great. Yes, absolutely. So now that I discovered Fabio has this incredible voice, we want to use it in all way possible.
Of
And
course.
so that, yes, the approach. Then with the next albums, we will focus even more. We have already great ideas and so on.
Well, to complement what you just said, I noticed on tracks like Decoding the Multiverse and I Am, for example, almost everything stops at one point in the song, and we get to hear only Fabio's voice for a few moments, which is great right? So congratulations on that as well.
This was, of course, inspired by Freddie, no? Because for Freddie was like that. I mean, when you have such a great voice, you want really to highlight it in all ways possible.
Of course, yeah. And I really love the cover art for the album, particularly how it kind of expands on the concept of the whole album. Who's the artist behind the art, and what kind of input did you give him or her?
The artist is I tell you it in the German way now, is Stefan Heilemann, because he is German. So he's a great guy. He makes cover for everybody almost. But it's great because still making the artworks for many bands, he's able to change the style, adapting it to every request. So in our case, I explained him the concept. I wanted to have this phoenix rising, this DNA that is very important, also in relation with the song DNA, all that, no? It gives this feeling of modernity, evolution, all that. And so I wanted to represent really this phoenix rising is a metaphoric way to express our inner side, no? And the way to abstract, to expand, to elevate, to ascend, leaving behind this kind of technological town representing, let's say, the material aspect of life, no? So yes, this was the basic concept.
And tell us about the title track Zero Gravity, if you can, because there's a lot of syncopation in the riffs on the song, a lot of stops and starts, and even a Middle Eastern vibe on certain parts. And the end result is absolutely epic. Can you elaborate a little bit on how that particular song was put together?
Thank you. This was incredible because this song was not supposed to be in the Rhapsody album, in the sense that I explain you briefly. When we decided to move on with to really Leonard Rhapsody, with such limited time for production, because everything had to be ready for July now, and the album would be released really on July, the 5th of July. And on the same day, we have the first festival. So just imagine in Europe, no? So it was incredible. I had a tough deadline. I even beat my record because I didn't sleep for 3 nights consecutively, was my record. So it was incredible. And to survive, to really be able to release this album, thanks to God, I had like 3 songs already ready for another project I was working on. And one of the songs was the song that became Zero Gravity. And so in some way I had just rearranged it for Rhapsody, but it was much faster than composing it from zero, of course, no? And it was great because then with the Fabio, voice of Fabio became even better than how I planned it before, no? So it was a great decision. So this is a song we all love. That's why it's giving the title to the album. That's why it will be the song of the video, of the official video, not just the lyric video, but the official one. It will be released sometimes, I think, around the release of the album, so in the first days of July. And so, yes, it's a special song because in it there is a little bit of everything. It's very representative of our new direction. There is everything, like you said. There is, I don't know, these epic choirs, so that we have the symphonic cinematic impact we all love, and it is a kind of trademark for Rhapsody. Of course, as you told, we have this ethnic ambient music that will be a fundamental part element for our new band, because before, with the Saga, we have this folklore. We had this Renaissance medieval music. Now we wanted to replace it with this emotional, soulful, ethnic music. Practicing yoga, I'm in love with all these sounds from these lands, from these different cultures, and so on. So yes, I think in every album we intend to put many, many different to take some sounds from the different corners of the world. And could be Asia, could be Persia, could be, doesn't matter, no? The important is the connection with the song and the feeling we want to transmit. And in this case, for Zero Gravity, we have this Indian folk, let's say, no? So I searched for this We made a long search to find these instruments. We have the sitar, the bansuri, many other instruments, specific percussions, all that. I think it's very important, no, to add the real flavor. So, and then, yes, then we have a super epic guitar solo. I wrote it really thinking to Hans Zimmer, you know, this kind of epic cinematic
Oh my.
composition. So yes, I think I really love the result, and yes, of course, it's one of our. And of course, it's funny because the people in the video will see me for the first time ever playing the piano, which is my favorite top of the top instruments nowadays. And so I'm proud to show myself playing the piano finally. I think it will be something very special for the fans.
Yeah. Will you be playing the piano live now or will you take the guitar? What's the
You know
plan?
what? Now in the first summer festivals, I don't think so, but we are planning something with the show starting from January, because we will start the worldwide tour starting with a European headliner tour. And so, as in the European, you know, for a festival, it's always difficult to set up things like that. You're in a hurry, you have to do fast like that. As it's something very important, we don't want to rush the things. So I think something like January from the next year, I think I will start dividing myself between the two instruments.
Oh, okay. And another track I'd love to explore is Amata Immortale, which is such a beautiful ballad. Talk about this one a little bit if you can.
Okay, speaking about piano, of course,
Yeah.
the intro is really inspired by Chopin. As I love Chopin, I want really to create an intro of piano really romantic in some way, very romantic, no? I am a romantic guy, so for me it's natural. So yes, and I think it's the perfect introduction for the styled interpretation of Fabio, for the following interpretation of Fabio, because in that song he's putting really all his heart and soul. And yes, of course, we have this operatic way of singing. The lyrics are in Italian, because this is a must in some way, no? I mean, I love to write in Italian. The Italian is not the typical modern Italian language, no? It's something more related to the Italian of the past, to give some particular specific atmosphere.
Right.
And then, yes, of course, the super epic orchestra, choir, all that. I think we will always love to have something like that in our albums because again, as I told you before, thanks to Fabio's incredible skills, this is possible. So why not?
Yeah, of course. Of course, have to use the best of what you got, man. Yeah. And do you anticipate a lot of changes in the arrangements of the songs in order to play them live or not?
No, but in the end, it's never a problem for Rhapsody in the sense that we have always had the playbacks, no? Since the early years, we were one of the first bands playing with the playbacks on stage, things like that. After us, then all the bands started, and
Yeah.
now it's kind of natural. So maybe also when we play on stage, I will play some main keyboard lines, but still there will be the playbacks behind them because for a band like Rhapsody, the arrangements are essential. I spend most of the time working on the arrangements, but much more than on the guitar, even if the work for the guitar on this album was particularly hard and long, no? But still, for me, the arrangement zone is the most important one, the most meaningful for me, no? I could not even think to have a band without arrangements. I would not even like it, honestly.
Yeah, of course. And would you say it's a similar process of the original Rhapsody of Fire versus your solo material, Dream Quest, Luca Turilli's Rhapsody, and the new lineup, the new band that you are now fronting or not?
Let's say that this was kind of winning formula, and when you have a winning formula, you don't change, no? Everything was so fluent, everything is so fluent in the process, in the collaboration with the guys that you know already since many years, things like that. Now with Fabio, we spent so much time in the studio, not because it was difficult for him to sing the vocal lines, that's absolutely not the case, but really because of the interpretation, we wanted to try different moods, different feelings, and this is great and it's possible only when you work already with your partner since many years and you know that you can really get the best because you know him perfectly, all that. So, I mean, I would never change such a winning formula.
Right, right. And, well, speaking of touring that we just touched on, I've seen shows announced for the summer festivals in Europe, of course, a tour in Japan, another one in Australia. Will more dates be announced soon? And is there a chance of you guys playing North America this time or not?
But of course, sooner or later, we come there. But still, at the moment, I have no news or information about this.
Okay. Well, I guess North America is a tough market, right? Because depending on the region, it's a different audience, different market to conquer and whatnot. So it is tough to break through, right?
Yes, except for Canada, where, let's say, it's more easy for us to play, no? Uh-huh. As you can imagine, because, yes, we have a good fan base there. Of course, in U.S., depending on the area, everything is changing, no?
Yeah.
So, of course, this you have to take care to not lose too much money, things like that. It's always this that... But we see now, because maybe with our new style like that, of course, what we were playing before, this kind of speed metal, was kind of super, super, super underground in US. But let's see if now, being more modern, with this kind of low-tuned, heavy guitars, we love, me and Fabio, right now, we are updating ourselves automatically to this kind of modern, let's say, metal that maybe could find more appreciations also in that huge country.
Yeah, yeah. I noticed in the production side as well that you just mentioned how crispy and loud the bass and drum sounds are on many parts of the album, like Fast Radio Burst or Multidimensional, for example. They sound incredible. Were Patrice and Alex 100% free to create those bass lines and drum parts or not?
No, normally I start with the basic bass lines, no?
Okay.
This is fundamental for me because, you know, when you compose a tone, I cannot compose a song if I don't start from the drums, the bass, like that, no? Mm-hmm. So the formula was always the same, always. We normally find ourselves in the rehearsing room just in the end before playing a jig.
Uh-huh.
So, but in the beginning, during the composition process, I start with the basics because otherwise I could not even start creating a song, no?
Right.
So, and then of course, when you have already, let's say, 70-80%, and you want really to have a great part like that, then I approach the others and we start speaking about this and there. Sometimes they like already almost everything. Sometimes no, they say, I can really improve based on their skills. And most of the time is also Alex, you know, I'm not a drummer. For the bass is something different because being a guitar player is kind of easy to create the bass lines, no?
Yeah.
In the style I like.
Right.
But for the drumming is different. So I create some basic drum patterns I like, and then we complicate them or we change some breaks, things like that. It's a kind of winning formula, as I said to you, and we go very, very fast. If we would start thinking to find ourselves in a rehearsing room, trying to put something together, it would be impossible
right.
for me.
Right. Let me just tell you from my personal experience, because I got the album last night at 10 p.m., and I did two listens just to prepare for the interview, and I love it. So I cannot wait for this to hit the markets and get the reception it deserves.
you know, this is a transition album, what we define it as, no?
Okay.
So in some way, it's an album like, I don't know if you know bands like Nightwish.
Of course,
big
yeah.
Bands like this. Hey, for example, it's an album of passage like the Nightwish had between Wishmaster and Once.
Mm-hmm.
So when they change, they modify their style because they really felt they wanted to do something else, but still, of course, having some elements of the past. So in this kind of transition, you lose some fans, you confirm some, and you get new fans. So all depends on this kind of process, how this gets... But in the end, our case is much more easy, the Nightwish, because they made this change after a successful album, while we are doing this, after a farewell tour that saw us playing for 2 years on all the stages of the world, the old hits, no?
Mm-hmm.
So of the early years. So it's a more distinct thing. So I think the fans will appreciate it in some way.
I hope so, man. I hope, like I said, I hope it gets the reception it deserves. Yeah. Well, we are wrapping up now, man. So thank you so much for your time. And I hope to see you down the road very soon.
Thank you, my friend. Absolutely. I'm sure we will like over there, so we will have the chance to meet for sure.
Right. I'll keep my fingers crossed. Thanks, Luca. Thank you so much. Thank you.
Thank you, Rodrigo. It was a pleasure. Ciao.
Likewise. Ciao. Ciao. Bye-bye.
Okay, folks, that's a wrap. Thank you for listening to this interview with Luca Turilli. And if you enjoyed this one, please show us some love and follow Sonic Perspectives on the usual social media channels, Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. Once again, I'm Rodrigo Altaf, and I'll leave you now with the song Phoenix Rising from Turilli Leone's Rhapsody's latest album, Zero Gravity, Rebirth, and Evolution. Take care and rock on!
Consciousness grows you, and the shock is gone and brave.